Good morning. It is Tuesday, September the 7th, and this is The Drill. Welcome to all the butchers, bakers, and candlestick makers out there. I'm Ron, your host and the only true conservative in the United States today. So today I'm going to be reading from the book Polemics by Christopher Snowden. I was reading a chapter from that, and it's about alcohol and the nanny state. And also I'm going to be reading another selection by from Thomas Jefferson's, the complete works of Thomas Jefferson, and also have some other selections. But first we're going to do the offer up the Daily Declaration for Spiritual Warfare. Remind everybody that the battle at the root of things is between God and Satan. And it is good for us to get our minds right in that regard. Then we're going to offer up the Pledge of Allegiance, sing the Star Spangled Banner, because true conservatives are the only ones that are patriotic and that can be patriotic. And then we'll have some content and then conclude with America the Beautiful and some closing remarks. All that when I come back. Thank you, and this is the Daily Declaration for Spiritual Warfare for September 7th. I will show you my glory. Moses longed to see my glory and to dwell in my shadow. He sought hard after me, and I knew him intimately. He found grace in my sight, and I knew him by name. My child, seek after me intimately, so that I will know you by name. Ask to see my glory, just as Moses asked. I will cause my goodness to pass before you. My goodness includes the blessings of goods, good things, goodness, property, fairness, beauty, joy, and prosperity. I have an abundant store of goodness, and I am anxious to give good gifts to my children. My blessings are stored up for those who know me and those whom I know. All you have to do is ask me to bless you. Prayer Declaration. Lord, you are the source of my blessing. I choose your blessings by walking in your covenant. I will knock on the door of blessing, and you will open it to me. You are a God who blesses and rewards those who diligently seek after you. Rain upon my life and pour out your blessing over me. Amen. And this reminds you, and should remind you, that the relationship that we have with God is personal. Okay, it's not, this is not like idol worshiping or anything of that nature. So it is a personal, you have a personal relationship with God, you follow in God's good footsteps, and God will reward you. And again, this is also a reminder that the battles that we go through each and every day culturally are at root spiritual battles, battles against Satan and his minions. Thank you very much. So again, we're still on about Afghanistan. Like I said, Hugh Hewitt's going to milk this for all it's worth. He's going to, he's bound and determined to shame the United States to the point where we're going to be internationally completely ineffective. And that's too bad that he's that stupid, but not much else I can do about it. One of the other things I wanted to say about Afghanistan, though, was there's always the talk, because now the talk is about who's been left behind and whether or not we got everybody. And Hugh Hewitt has to make sure that he goes ahead and shames the administration so that he can think to himself that he's had some kind of, made some sort of an effort or contributed to a Republican sweep in 2022. Shame on him. Anyways, he is talking about they're talking about people getting out, Afghans and Americans. Now, here's a situation where, again, neutrality says it doesn't matter. Everybody's a human being, so you just get as many people, try to get everybody out, and you don't set any priorities. Wrong. We're American citizens. We pay American taxes. Americans come first. That's the right thing to do. You put the context to the situation. I'm looking at this as an American, and that means Americans come first, especially in the face that there's a lot of talk about Afghans, in the face of the cowardice and the greed of the Afghan people that we are attempting to extricate from Afghanistan, the ones that wanted to, that are trying to avoid the Taliban. Why are they avoiding Taliban? Because these are Afghans that worked for the United States. Why did they work for the United States? Did they work for the United States out of principle? Because they want to, Afghanistan to become another United States of America? No. Because they value freedom? No. They did it because of greed. They knew that the United States was going to pay them more and pay them better than their own government will. And so that's why they want to work for the United States. And so now all of a sudden there's these people on the left, Nancy Pelosi, that are wringing their hands about, oh, what about all the poor Afghanis that, hey, first, American citizens first and foremost because they're American citizens. That's all there is to it. They come out first. There shouldn't be one single Afghani on any plane until every American that wants to come out, that should come out, gets out. Then we can look at the Afghanis. I mean, the Afghani people are really, really horrible people. They are, like I said, cowards, the most gutless of people, and the most greedy. The whole reason they're fleeing the country is they know the Taliban is going to put them up against a wall and shoot them. Because basically these people have been traitors to their own country. And they did it for money, for the basest of reasons, money. So they can, for self-aggrandizement, they can make more money. And we've been there for 20 years. And if these folks didn't save up their ducats over the course of those 20 years and find a way to get out of the country or otherwise settle themselves in Afghanistan where they're going to be shielded from prosecution from the Taliban, etc. In other words, they didn't bother to look forward. That's their problem. I really don't like the Afghani people based on what I see, and I just don't like them. I don't have any respect for them. They're not willing to fight. As soon as they got the opportunity to fight, the first thing they did was throw down their weapons and run away. Then they go to the airport and they say, "Oh, United States of America, help me, help me." No. Screw you. It's your country. Stay and fight. And if you're just going to throw down your weapons, then all I can say is get out on your prayer carpet and pray to Allah that the Taliban has mercy on you. Thank you. Thank you. And this is chapter, 24? I think 25, Bootleggers and Baptists in the Nighttime Economy, from Christopher Snowden's book called Polemics. Al Capone and the Anti-Saloon League had little in common except a shared interest in restricting the legal sale of alcohol. Economists often refer to bootleggers and Baptists when they see an unlikely alliance of financial and ideological interest groups pushing for regulations that will punish consumers. Police in London have followed the lead of their counterparts in Norwich and Loughborough by forming a partnership with nightclub owners to breathalyze customers on the door. This initiative has been criticized for combining the infantilization of the nanny state with the intrusiveness of Big Brother. And so it does. But few have commented on its most objectionable aspect, which is that it is a shameless piece of rent-seeking. It is a straightforward example of corporate interests working with the state to enrich themselves at the expense of their customers and competition. One of the ostensible justifications for the scheme is that breathalyzers provided by the state will provide useful evidence to doormen when they are trying to convince belligerent drunks that they are too inebriated to come in. This is unconvincing. Bouncers are big boys and can look after themselves. But if they say you're not coming in, you're not coming in. A more candid justification for the measure is that it is intended to clamp down on preloading, the perfectly legal act of drinking alcohol in one's home before going out. The licensed trade dislikes preloading because customers arrive later and drink less. The temperance lobby, which now operates under the guise of public health, dislikes it because it allows people to drink cheaper alcohol bought from supermarkets. And so, in a classic bootleggers and Baptists alliance, these traditional foes have found common cause in spreading the belief that the off-trade is responsible for alcohol-related problems which occur in and around the on-trade. The police have now been co-opted into a scheme devised by operators in the nighttime economy to nobble their competitors in the off-trade. There's an unmistakable whiff of hypocrisy in the licensed trade's pious condemnation of so-called preloading. Their complaint is that their customers arrive tipsy and leave plastered, and that the blame lies with those who made them merry rather than those who got them sozzled. But insofar as a business can be held held responsible for its customers' behavior, it is surely the person who served them their last drink who is more culpable than those who served them their first. No one seriously believes that nightclub owners object to people getting drunk on a Friday or Saturday night. Imagine how these licensees would squeal if it was suggested that customers be breathalyzed inside their premises every few hours, with those who exceed a benchmark of inebriation being ejected by orders of the police. The real objection of pub and club owners is not to people getting drunk, but to people getting drunk elsewhere, arriving half-cut and needing relatively little further refreshment. They stand to profit enormously from a de facto ban on preloading. The question is whether the police should be helping them. The police are not entirely hapless dupes in this. Some of them doubtless believe that late-night policing will be made easier if patrons come into town stone-cold sober. And yet it is surely more likely that customers will make up for lost time by drinking more inside the club. This is presumably what the owners of pubs and clubs expect. Why else would they be collaborating with the police if they did not think it would lead to more sales? The breathalyzing scheme remains voluntary for now, but it's not difficult to see how it could become mandatory over time. Evidence could be found or concocted to show that participating venues benefit from less alcohol-related violence, or that problems have been displaced from venues which use breathalyzers to those which do not. Either way, it will be argued that a level playing field should be created in which all venues adopt this evidence-based policy. And since some venues refuse to take part, a little compulsion is necessary. At first, it might be suggested that new licenses can only be approved if proprietors take part in the voluntary scheme. Once this principle has been established, campaigners will complain about the loophole that exempts older venues. Local bylaws, national legislation will be proposed as the next logical step. In a slight twist on Adam Smith's famous comment about what happens when people of the same trade seldom meet, this would result in an industry which offers merriment and diversion, forming a conspiracy against the public. When corporate interests collude with the state, it is the ordinary consumer who pays the price. In this instance, weekend revelers must either pay more, drink less, or stay home. They will lose out financially or be denied their first-order preference, or both. Nightclubs have an obvious incentive for wanting customers to be thirsty on arrival, but if they wish to make blood alcohol levels a criteria for entry. They should buy their own breathalyzers and police it themselves. The state should not be lending its apparatus to private interests to pursue financial rewards. And all of this is, and that was chapter 25 of the book by Christopher Snowden entitled Polemics. And so, again, this is all about, at the end of the day, it's all about determinism and the idea that you must have the state is the only thing powerful enough to break the power of, in this particular case, the alcohol lobby. The alcohol lobby is forcing people to get drunk, and the state needs to get involved to force them not to get people drunk, or put a wedge, so to speak, between people and the alcohol industry. Same thing that you have here going on in the United States with tobacco, big tobacco and big oil and whatnot, that the people in government assume a leadership role because they believe that their constituents are incompetent because they are held under the sway of big corporate interests. And so it is their job to go in and force people to do the right thing, when in reality, no such thing. There's nowhere in the Constitution or any political theory, particularly about democracy, that says it's a good democratic practice for representatives to pretend that they're leaders. So again, here you are having a situation where and this is again in England, of course, and where customers preload, because I imagine the reason that the prices are higher in the taverns, and this is another case where, by the way, where the left creates a problem and then steps in and says, oh, look at this problem. Isn't this fascinating? There's a problem here. Let us help you solve it. And it's the problem they created in the first place. And they don't really try to help you solve the problem, because in order to solve that problem, it would be to take away the problem you created in the first place. For instance, the pubs are, I'm sure, charging more because in part they're paying higher taxes, fees, etc., that the state has imposed on them and may be imposed on them as a way of trying to reduce alcohol consumption. So the consumer finds a way around this by saying, that's okay, I'll go to the grocery store, I'll buy my whiskey or whatever at the grocery store, then I'll have a couple of drinks at home, then I'll go to the pub, and that way I can keep my prices under control. I still get to drink whatever I want, and I still get the opportunity to socialize. So again, the left creates the problem by creating the taxes and the fees that raise the price of drinkings in the pubs. The public responds to that by going to the grocery store to get their liquor, and then the left says, oh, look at this. Look at this problem here. Because then, of course, the pubs are complaining that they're not making enough money because the state is basically chased away their customers. But again, instead of the state saying, okay, let's cut the taxes, let's cut the fees, or eliminate them entirely and allow these pubs to make their money, they say, oh, well, look at this problem. Well, we're not going to lighten the load in terms of regulation. So instead, we're just going to impose more regulation. We're going to become more restrictive with using breathalyzers to try to get these naughty customers who are trying to go around the system, keep these naughty customers from going to the grocery store and getting cheap liquor. So again, the left creates a problem, and then the left acts surprised when there's consequences, or they create what they think of as a solution, turns out to be a problem, they act surprised, and their answer is always more restrictions and never less. They never say, oh, look at this, it didn't go the way we thought it was going to go, let's get rid of it. Never that. Always more, 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 more. And that's how you go from a free country, a democratic society, to becoming a despotic socialist style government, little by little, gradual by gradual. So the way to deal with this is you got to tell your politicians, determinism is dead. Okay, when they're proposing any type of new government regulations, or perhaps they're going to propose that existing regulations be tightened or whatnot, you've got to tell them determinism is dead. We can, the average individual can fend for themselves. We don't need representatives. We don't need you to be interfering or trying to protect us from ourselves. Thank you, thank you. And now the another 6 pages or so of the complete works of Thomas Jefferson. And this is an autobiography, part of his autobiography. Nothing of particular excitement occurring for a considerable time, our countrymen seemed to fall into a state of insensibility to our situation. The duty on tea, not yet repealed, and the declaratory act of a right in the British Parliament to bind us by their laws in all cases whatsoever, still suspended over us. But a court of inquiry held in Rhode Island in 1762, with a power to send persons to England to be tried for offenses committed here, was considered at our session of the spring of 1773 as demanding attention. Not thinking of our old and leading members up to the point of forwardness and zeal with which the times required, Mr. Henry, Richard Henry Lee, Francis L. Lee, Mr. Carr, and myself agreed to meet in the evening in a private room of the Raleigh to consult on the state of things. There may have been a member or two whom I do not recollect. We were all sensible to the most urgent of all measures was that of coming to an understanding with all the other colonies to consider the British claims as a common cause to all and to produce a unity of action, and, for this purpose, that a committee of correspondence in each colony would be the best instrument for intercommunication, and that their first measure would probably be to propose a meeting of deputies from every colony at some central place who should be charged with the direction of the measures which should be taken by all. We, therefore, drew upon the resolutions which may be seen in writ, page 87. The consulting members proposed to me to move them, but I urged that it should be done by Mr. Carr, my friend and brother-in-law, then a new member, to whom I wished an opportunity should be given of making known to the House his great worth and talents. It was so agreed. He moved them, they were agreed to, and a committee of correspondence appointed, of whom Peyton Randolph, the Speaker, was chairman. The governor, then Lord Dunmore, dissolved us, but the committee met the next day, prepared a circular letter to the speakers of the other colonies, enclosing to each a copy of the resolutions, and left it in charge with their chairman to forward them by expresses. The origination of these committees of correspondence between the colonies has been since claimed for Massachusetts, and Marshall has given into this error, although the very note of this appendix to which he refers shows that their establishment was confined to their own towns. This matter will be seen clearly stated in a letter of Samuel Adams Wells to me of April 2, 1819, and my answer of May 12. I was corrected by the letter of Mr. Wells and the information I had given Mr. Wirt, as stated in his note, page 87, that the messengers of Massachusetts and Virginia crossed each other on the way, bearing similar propositions, for Mr. Wells shows that Massachusetts did not adopt the measure, but on the receipt of our proposition, delivered at their next session. The message, therefore, which passed ours, must have related to something else, for I well remember Peyton Randolph's informing me of the crossing of our messengers. The next event which excited our sympathies for Massachusetts was the Boston Port Bill, by which that port was to be shut up on the 1st of June, 1774. This arrived while we were in session in the spring of that year. The lead in the House on these subjects being no longer left to the old members, Mr. Henry R.H. Lee, Mr. L. Lee, 3 or 4 other members whom I do not recollect, and myself agreeing that we must boldly take an unequivocal stand in the line with Massachusetts, determined to meet and consult on the proper measures in the council chamber for the benefit of the library in that room. We were under conviction of the necessity of arousing our people from the lethargy into which they had fallen and to passing events, and thought that the appointment of a day of general fasting and prayer would be most likely to call up and alarm their attention. No example of such a solemnity had existed since the days of our distresses in the War of 55, since which a new generation had grown up, with the help, therefore, of Rushworth, whom he rummaged over for the revolutionary precedents and forms of the Puritans of that day. Preserved by him, we cooked up a resolution somewhat modernizing their phrases for appointing the first day of June in which the Port Bill was to commence for a day of fasting, humiliation, and prayer, to employ heaven to avert us from the evils of civil war, to inspire us with firmness in support of our rights, and to turn the hearts of the King and Parliament to moderation and justice. To give greater emphasis to our proposition, we agreed to wait the next morning on Mr. Nicholas, whose grave and religious character is more in unison with the tone of our resolution, and to solicit him to move it. We accordingly went to him in the morning. We moved it the same day. The 1st of June was proposed, and it passed without opposition. The governor dissolved us, as usual. We retired to the Apollo, as before, agreed to an association, and instructed the Committee of Correspondence to propose to the corresponding committees of the other colonies to appoint deputies to meet in Congress at such place annually as should be convenient to direct from time to time the measure required by the general interest. And we declared that the attack on any one colony should be considered as an attack on the whole. This was in May. We further recommended the several counties to elect deputies to meet at Williamsburg the 1st of August ensuing to consider the state of the colony, and particularly to appoint delegates to a general Congress, should that measure be acceded to by the committees of correspondence generally. It was acceded to. Philadelphia was appointed for the place, and the 5th of September for the time of meeting. We returned home, and in our several counties invited the clergy to meet assemblies of the people on the 1st of June to perform the ceremonies of the day and to address them to the discourses suited to the occasion. The people met generally with anxiety and alarm in their countenances, and the effect of the day through the whole colony was like a shock of electricity, arousing every man and placing him erect and solidly on his center. They chose universally delegates for the convention. Being elected one for my own county, I prepared a draft of instructions to be given to the delegates whom we should send to Congress, which I meant to propose at our meeting. In this, I took the ground that, from the beginning, I had thought the only one orthodox or tenable, which was that the relation between Great Britain and these colonies was exactly the same as that of England and Scotland after the accession of James, and until the Union, and the same as her present relationships with Hanover, having the same executive chief, but no other necessary political connection, and that our emigration from England to this country gave her no more rights over us than the emigrations of the Danes and Saxons gave to the present authorities of the mother country over England. In this doctrine, however, I'd never been able to get anyone to agree with me but Mr. Wythe. He concurred in it from the first dawn of the question. What was the political relation between us and England? Our other patriots, Randolph, the Lees, Nicholas, Pendleton, stopped at the halfway house of John Dickinson, who admitted that England had a right to regulate our commerce and to lay duties on it for the purposes of regulation, but not of raising revenue. But for this ground, there was no foundation in compact, in any acknowledged principles of colonization, nor in reason. Expatriation being a natural right, and acted on as such by all nations in all ages, I set out for Williamsburg some days before that appointed for our meeting, but was taken ill of a dysentery on the road and was unable to proceed. I sent on, therefore, to Williamsburg two copies of my draft, the one under cover to Peyton Randolph, who I knew would be in the chair of the convention, the other to Patrick Henry. Whether Mr. Henry disapproved the ground taken or was too lazy to read it, for he was the laziest man in reading I ever knew, I never learned, but he communicated it to nobody. Peyton Randolph informed the convention he had received such a paper from a member, prevented by sickness from offering it in his place, and he laid it on the table for perusal. It was read generally by the members, approved by many, though thought too bold for the present state of things. But they printed it in a pamphlet form under the title of A Summary View of the Rights of British America. It found its way to England, was taken up by the opposition, interpolated a little by Mr. Burke, so as to make it answer opposition purposes, and in that form ran rapidly through several editions. This information I had from Parson Hurt, who happened at the time to be in London, whither he had gone to receive clerical orders, and I was informed afterwards by Peyton Randolph that it had procured me the honor of having my name inserted in a long list of proscriptions enrolled in a bill of attainder commenced in one of the Houses of Parliament, but suppressed in embryo by the hasty step of events, which warned them to be a little cautious. Montague, agent of the House of Burgesses in England, made extracts from the bill, copied the names, and sent them to Peyton Randolph. The names, I think, were about 20, which he repeated to me, but I recollect those only of Hancock, the two Adamses, Peyton Randolph himself, Patrick Henry, and myself. The convention met on the 1st of August, renewed their association, appointed delegates to the Congress, gave them instructions very temperately and properly expressed, both as to style and matter, and they repaired to Philadelphia at the time appointed. The splendid proceedings of that Congress at their first session belong to general history and are known to everyone and need not, therefore, be noted here. They terminated their session on the 26th of October to meet again on the 10th of May ensuing. The convention, at their ensuing session in March 75, approved of the proceedings of Congress, thanked their delegates, and reappointed the same persons to represent the colony at the meeting to be held in May, and foreseeing the probability that Peyton Randolph, their president and speaker also of the House of Burgesses, might be called off, they added me in that event to the delegation. And so that's another 6 pages or so of the book, The Complete Works of Thomas Jefferson. Here is he is creating an autobiography, and so it's part of that autobiography. But again, I read all of this because, not so much for the content, because, I mean, Mr. Randolph and the House of Burgesses and all that kind of thing, I get lost in all that. But I love the way that he and Hamilton and all the Founding Fathers communicated. They communicated with concepts. They communicated with abstractions. Very, very little storytelling or verbal picture painting. They communicated like modern human beings. And so that's what I want to impress on everybody. You want to be a true conservative, then you have to, it's a lifestyle. Being true conservative is a lifestyle, and the way you communicate is as important as anything else. Fantastic. And so I wanted to remind everybody, I'm selling a companion book in the Kindle bookstore. It's an ebook called The Drill, and it's $2.99. But if you have Kindle Unlimited, you can read it for free. This is the first edition. I'll have a second edition out in the middle of November. So also I want to remind you that another excellent example of people that communicate and think in a conservative manner is the John and Ken Show, and that is on 2 to 6 p.m. Pacific time, Monday through Friday. They were off on vacation yesterday, but should be back today. So until next time, remember to be honest, be smart, be beautiful, and remember that the left has no authority, no power, and they can't win.